Hello everybody, welcome to this session on ECG part 1, and today we are going to be learning the basics of ECG, how to identify the most easy type of ECGs for the exam, and by the end of this class you are going to be a master in ECG. So we are going to be having two different classes for this. This is the first part. First of all, I hope you guys are able to see me and hear me well. My name is Dr. Janvi. I am the anesthesia educator on An Academy. And if the streaming is okay, please leave a thumbs up in the chat box and we can continue with the class. I can see your comments. I can see whatever you guys are writing. Okay, yes. So I can see that you all can see me and hear me well. Okay. So in this class, we are going to be discussing all the different types of ECGs that can be asked in your exam. What is the basics of an ECG? How does an ECG happen? How do you record it? What does the ECG paper mean? All of that. Alright. So let's begin with our class for today. The plus subscription on An Academy will help you get access to both live and recorded classes. You can learn from India's top educators. You can compete in live tests and quizzes. You can study on the device of your choice. You can access our question bank with 25,000 plus questions. And we also have printed notes for those who buy the 1 year and above subscription. Then we have a partnership with PrepLadder, in which we will be providing you with the live lectures of An Academy and the notes and lectures, recorded lectures of PrepLadder. So that is a part of the Iconic subscription. In our special classes, we have this raise a hand option, in which we will allow you to speak to the educator during a live class. So you can use that option and you can talk to the educator during the live class. And we have a limited time offer going on right now for the subscription. So you can see a 12-month subscription is costing you just 38,250 and so on. And in our special classes, we have features like they are interactive, we have polls, you can speak to the educator, you also get PDF notes at the end of the class. And our question bank has 25,000 plus high yield questions, from which questions of all the exams, NEET, PG, FMG comes. And these are a few of our batches which are going on right now. The Mission INICET batch. Then we have the Target Next 2022 batch for NEET PG students appearing in 2022. Target Next 2023 batch. It's an integrated batch. Then we have a few offers going on for our subscriptions. You can buy the 2-year subscription, get 4 months free, or buy the 12-year subscription, get 2 months free. And if you guys would like to buy the subscription, don't forget to use my code Dr. Janvi Life, and that will give you a extra 10% off on your subscription value. Alright? Okay, so let's begin with our class for today. First of all, can you guys see this and tell me what exactly am I showing you over here? Okay, so it's already written, I'm showing you the electrical activation of the heart. So can anyone tell me, in the electrical activation of the heart, which is the most important part? When you're talking about the heart rhythm happening or the electrical activity of the heart happening, what is the most important part? Any idea? I want this to be a very interactive session. Okay, so the most important part is your SA node, and your SA node is called as the pacemaker of the heart, correct? Why is it called as the pacemaker of the heart? You can see over here, this blue thing over here is your SA node, and the SA node is generating the impulse. So it is also the impulse generator. It generates the electrical activity of the heart, okay? Then from the SA node, this electrical activity will spread to two places. Through the normal atrial tissue, it will spread to the interatrial septum, and then it will spread to the right atrium. That is one of the places the electrical activity will spread to. The other, it will travel through the specialized conduction pathway. And what is the specialized conduction pathway? From the SA node to the AV node, atrioventricular node. Okay, this atrioventricular node is present at the base of the interatrial septum. After that, it will pass to the SA node, AV node, bundle of His. from the bundle of his to the Purkinje fibers. Now these are two main Purkinje fibers. One is going to the right side and one is going to the left side. So you have right Purkinje fibers and left Purkinje fibers, and then right and left bundle branches, and then these bundle branches will give out the small Purkinje fibers, which will spread the electrical activity to every layer of the heart, every muscle of the heart. Okay, so again telling you the whole process very briefly, very quickly. The SA node is the pacemaker of the heart. Okay, so it will basically generate the impulse. Once the SA node generates the impulse, it will spread through the interatrial septum to the left side and it will make the left atrium contract. Okay, then it will also spread through specialized conductive tissue to the AV node, from the AV node to the bundle of His, from the bundle of His to the right and left bundle branches, and from the right and left bundle branches to your Purkinje fibers. Okay, now can anyone tell me which one is your bigger ventricle? Is it the left ventricle or is it the right ventricle which is bigger? Is it the left ventricle or the right ventricle which is bigger? Okay, we all know that the left ventricle is bigger, it has more muscular mass. Okay, so abhi kya hota hai, if I'm just drawing a simple heart diagram over here, if your left ventricle is bigger over here, to spread the electrical activity to the left ventricle, just having one bundle branch is not enough. Okay, so from the bundle of His, you have the right bundle branch growing and the left bundle branch growing. So this left bundle branch will then divide into two. One is the left anterior bundle branch and one is the left posterior bundle branch. Okay, because the muscular mass in the left ventricle is more, that's why to spread all along it, you have division of the bundle branches into left anterior and left posterior bundle branch. Okay, and then from there you will have your Purkinje fibers going out. Clear? So that is about our heart. This is also called as the conducting system of the heart. So this SA node, AV node, bundle of His, Purkinje fibers are all specialized conducting fibers. They have less refractory period, they get excited easily, they transmit all the signals and impulses easily. On the other hand, if you have to spread these electrical impulses through the normal muscular tissue of the heart, it will take much more time as compared to the spread from the conducting tissue. Okay, so this is the basics of the heart. All right, now how do we correlate the basics of the heart with the ECG? So can anyone tell me, what does your P wave stand for? What does your QRS wave stand for? What does your T wave stand for? What does your U wave stand for? Any idea? I don't know if you guys would have seen this very simple ECG. Always we see ECG like this. Okay? We see a 12-lead ECG and we look at it and then we get scared and we say, "Arey, hume ECG mein kuch aata hi nahi hai." बट अगर ECG का बेसिक्स ही नहीं देखा है तो तुमको बड़ा वाला ECG कैसे आएगा? करेक्ट? इफ यू सी अ सिंपल स्ट्रिप ऑफ द ECG, ओनली देन यू विल रियलाइज हाउ इज अ बेसिक ECG. सो इफ यू लुक एट दिस बेसिक ECG, यू कैन सी द P वेव फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल ओवर हियर. करेक्ट? सो व्हाट डज द P वेव स्टैंड फॉर? द P वेव विल स्टैंड फॉर योर डीपोलराइजेशन और कॉन्ट्रैक्शन. Atrial depolarization, which is nothing but atrial contraction. Okay, so whenever your left atrium and right atrium contract, you will have the generation of the P wave. After that, the impulse spreads from the atria to the ventricles, so that takes some time. So that is your PR interval. Okay, that gives you the impulse, the duration of impulse spreading from the atria to the ventricles, from the SA node to the AV node. After that you have your QRS wave. Now what does your QRS wave tell you? The QRS wave, as you can see, is a tall wave, it's a big wave. Okay, so this is telling you about your ventricular contraction. Sorry, this was telling you about atrial contraction, your P wave. Your QRS wave is telling you about your ventricular contraction. Okay, so when your ventricle contracts, you will see the QRS wave appearing. Next we have this interval which is called as the QT interval. So the QT interval is the interval when your ventricle starts relaxing, okay, and T wave will give you your ventricular relaxation or ventricular repolarization. After this, what does the U wave stand for? We will see ahead. Okay, now what is a U wave? Now U wave, actually you can see it normally also. It basically tells you about your muscle mass, which is again relaxing, your ventricular muscle mass which is relaxing, and the spread to the left through the rest of the atrium which starts contracting, okay. But sometimes these U waves become pathological. So in which cases do your U waves become pathological? So this question will come in the exam. What are the causes of abnormal U waves, or what are the causes of pathological U waves? So this you should remember from the mnemonic mithai deke. Okay, so aapko U waves kaise dikhenge? You can remember it as hame mithai deke U waves dikhenge. Okay, so mithai deke, M-I-T-H, mithai ka M-I-T-H, and then deke ke liye D and K. Okay, so M is for hypomagnesemia. So if your magnesium levels are low, you will see abnormal U waves. Next, I is for raised ICP. So you will see when patients come with head injury, or you have someone who is coming with some tumor in the brain, okay, brain tumor, and they all present with raised ICP. So when you do their ECG, you will see bradycardia, you will see abnormal U waves in them, okay. Then next is hypothermia or decreased temperature, in which you will see U waves. Next is HOCM, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, and then you have DK is a digoxin toxicity, and reduced potassium, that is hypokalemia. Abhi exam mein how does this question come? It's one of the most question important and common questions that's asked about ECG. So they will ask you which of these is a cause of U waves. So hypokalemia hamesha option mein rehta hai, and remember sometimes they also put hypothermia. So if you tell me, ma'am, I cannot remember this whole mnemonic, just tell me 2-3 causes for abnormal U waves. So 2-3 causes that you should remember for abnormal U waves. Abnormal U waves is your hypokalemia, hypothermia and hypomagnesemia. Okay? So low potassium, low magnesium and low temperature. In tino mein you will get pathological U waves. Clear? Okay. Next, this is a normal ECG. If you look at it, this is a normal 12 lead ECG. So in 12 lead ECG, what are you getting? You are getting lead 1, you are getting lead 2, you are getting lead 3, you are getting lead AVR, AVL, AVF, then V1, V2, V3, V4, V5, V6. अभी जो तुम लोग पूछोगे, मैम ये सब क्या है, इतने सारे लीड्स हमको नहीं समझ में आते हैं. हमको सब पता है that if you want to see any rhythm abnormality, regular rhythm, irregular rhythm, तो we have been told कि तुम lead 2 में देख लो, नीचे long lead 2 ऐसे आएगा, उसमें देख लो, है ना. And then वो myocardial infarction के लिए हमको बोला है, anterior wall के लिए see V3, V4, septal wall के लिए सी V1, V2, inferior wall के लिए सी 2-3 AVF. बहुत confusing है मैम, ECG तो हमें आता ही नहीं है. Many students come like this, but I tell them it's very simple if you understand this diagram. This diagram and the next diagram, okay. So these are two diagrams that if you understand now, you will always remember it for life, okay. So when we are putting limb leads and when we are putting chest leads. So your V1 to V6 are your chest leads. Okay. So chest leads, sirf ye diagram tumko yaad rakhna hai for the rest of your life, that I don't know how many of you all have taken an ECG. Write in the chat box how many of you all have actually taken an ECG. If you take an ECG, you must be putting all these leads, okay. So you start putting V1 from the right side of the body. So if this is the sternum, then V1 will come on the right parasternal area. V2 will come on the left parasternal area. So you are going from right to left, okay. then V3, V4, V5, V6. V5, V6 almost goes up till the axilla. V4 you will put at the level of the nipple, left sided nipple, and basically on each side of the sternum you put V1 and V2, and then V4 at the level of the nipple, and then V3 you put between V2 and V4. तो अगर तुमको कोई बोलेगा कि जाओ उसका ECG ले लो, तो अभी तुम सबको आना चाहिए हाउ टू पुट दीज चेस्ट लीड्स. ओके, वेरी ईजी. सबसे पहले V1 से स्टार्ट करो. V1 को स्टर्नम के राइट साइड पे डाल दो, फिर V2 को स्टर्नम के लेफ्ट साइड पे डाल दो, फिर V4 को निप्पल पे डाल दो, एंड V3 को V2 एंड V4 के बीच में डाल दो. ओके, और V5 V6 दोनों को एक्सिला में डाल दो, ठीक है, एंटीरियर एक्सिलरी लाइन तक. नाउ लुकिंग एट दिस, अगर तुमको पीछे यहाँ पे हार्ट दिख रहा है, ओके, दिस इज द राइट वेंट्रिकल, दिस इज द लेफ्ट वेंट्रिकल. सो कैन एनीवन टेल मी देन व्हाट विल दीज चेस्ट लीड्स करस्पॉन्ड टू, विच चेस्ट लीड्स विल करस्पॉन्ड टू विच वॉल ऑफ द हार्ट. So this becomes very easy now. So if you look at V1 and V2, it's showing you directly over here. And what is this? This is the septum, interventricular septum. So if there is any problem in the interventricular septum, then you will see it in lead V1 and lead V2. Okay, because see where these leads are showing. They are showing you near the septum. Okay, then lead V3 and lead V4 will mainly show you over the left ventricle, and the left ventricle mainly forms the anterior wall of the heart. ठीक है, ये देखो ऐसे जा रहा है, it's mainly showing you over the left side of the ventricle. So your V3 and V4 mainly shows you over the anterior wall of the heart. And then you have V5 and V6 जो एकदम axilla में चले गए हैं. सो इफ यू लुक एट V5 एंड V6, इधर से लाइन ड्रॉ करो तो दे आर शोइंग यू मोर ऑफ द लैटरल वॉल ऑफ द हार्ट, करेक्ट. सो V5 एंड V6 विल शो यू द लैटरल वॉल ऑफ द हार्ट. तो अभी ये फोटो से तुमको समझ में आ गया विच लीड, चेस्ट लीड इज शोइंग विच वॉल ऑफ द हार्ट. सो इफ आई स्टार्ट गेटिंग ST एलिवेशन इन V1 एंड V2, दैट मीन्स देर इज मायोकार्डियल इन्फार्क्शन इन द इंटरवेंट्रिकुलर सेप्टम. If I start getting ST elevation in V5 and V6, that means there is a myocardial infarction in the left lateral wall. Samajh mein aaya ya nahi? Tell me this, and if someone has not understood, I will happily repeat it again for you, because this is the very basic of your ECG, knowing where your leads are placed and which walls they show. I am expecting a reply from you guys on this. Very good. So Devesh is saying very clear. Okay, this was about your chest leads. So abhi if I look at this, now I know that my V1 is showing me septum, interventricular septum. V2 is showing septum. V3 and V4 are showing anterior wall, and my V5 and V6 are showing the left lateral wall. बराबर, ओके. नाउ वी हैव टू अंडरस्टैंड कि ये थे चेस्ट लीड्स. अभी लिम्ब लीड्स, लिम्ब लीड्स 1, 2, 3 AVR, AVL, AVF, ये क्या दिखाएंगे? अभी ये तो बहुत इजी हो जाते हैं. व्हेन वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट AVR, R मींस इट्स शोइंग द राइट साइड ऑफ द हार्ट, L मींस इट्स शोइंग द लेफ्ट साइड ऑफ द हार्ट, एंड F मींस it's showing the heart from the foot. So when you look at the heart from the foot, what do you see? Niche se dekhoge to you will see the inferior wall. The inferior wall of the heart is formed by the left ventricle and the right ventricle. So AVF will show you the inferior wall of the heart. So what about 1, 2, and 3? So now look at this picture. Okay, so this is the arrangement of the limb leads. So AVL, as I told you, is showing you the left side of the heart. AVR, as I told you, is showing you the right side of the heart. And AVF niche foot se dikh raha hai, okay, pair se dikh raha hai. So this is showing you the inferior wall of the heart, correct? Now you have to see the arrangement of lead 1, lead 2 and lead 3. अभी ऐसे याद रखो V1, V2, V3, V4, V5, V6 was coming from the right side to the left side, correct? Now 1, 2 and 3 is going ulta, it's going from the left side to the right side. So 1 will show you your left side of the heart, 2 and 3 are sort of showing you the inferior wall of the heart only. ठीक है, ये जो नीचे दोनों वेंट्रिकल है, राइट एंड लेफ्ट वेंट्रिकल, यही दिखा रहा है तुमको. सो नाउ व्हेन यू लुक एट इट, इट बिकम्स वेरी इजी फॉर यू टू आइडेंटिफाई कि योर वन एंड एवीएल विल शो यू द लेफ्ट लैटरल वॉल ऑफ द हार्ट, करेक्ट? सो वन एंड एवीएल विल शो यू द लेफ्ट लैटरल वॉल ऑफ द हार्ट. योर 2, 3 एंड एवीएफ इफ यू सी, इट्स शोइंग यू द inferior wall of the heart, the inferior wall that is formed by the left ventricle and the right ventricle. So 2, 3 and AVF is showing you the inferior wall of the heart, and your AVR is going to show you the right side of the heart. Okay, so right atrium plus right ventricle. So this is how your limb leads and chest leads are arranged to show you the different walls of the heart. तो फिर से एक बार देख लो clearly. अभी ये दो फोटो if you remember for life ECG will become extremely easy for you guys. So V1 and V2, if you see in this picture, V1 and V2 is showing you the interventricular septum, V3 and V4 is showing you the anterior wall which is formed by the left ventricle, V5 and V6 is showing you the left lateral wall. Similarly, your 1 and AVL is also showing you the left lateral wall, 2, 3 AVF is showing you the inferior wall, and AVR is showing you the right side of the heart. So, at the end of the day, if you have any problem, you have to just refer to where are you seeing the ST elevation in this ECG. This is my ECG, where am I seeing the ST elevation? Now, I want you guys to answer. Suppose I am seeing ST elevation here in 1, AVL, V5 and V6. If I am seeing ST elevation in 1, AVL, V5, V6. Now tell me, where is my myocardial infarction? In which wall is my myocardial infarction? In which wall is my heart not receiving blood supply correctly? If there is ST elevation in 1, AVL, V5, V6. Very good, Devesh. So this is in the lateral wall of the heart. Okay, lateral wall MI. अभी इसका correlation और क्या है कि my lateral wall of the heart is mainly supplied, left lateral wall is supplied by the left circumflex artery. So मतलब मेरा left circumflex artery में there is a thrombus, so I have to make sure that I remove the thrombus from my left circumflex artery. ठीक है, तो ऐसे सोचना होता है ECG चेंज देखने का, फिर सोचने का कौन से वॉल में प्रॉब्लम है, फिर वॉल से पता चलेगा कौन से आर्टरी में प्रॉब्लम है, कोरोनरी आर्टरी में, एंड देन यू कैन अराइव टू द डायग्नोसिस. ऑलराइट, सो दिस इज द बेसिक्स ऑफ ECG. नाउ यू हैव टू गो टू द वेरी बेसिक ऑफ योर ECG पेपर. ओके, तो अभी जो हमारा ECG पेपर होता है उसके बारे में आई हैव अ फ्यू क्वेश्चंस फॉर यू गाइज, एंड आई वांट टू सी इफ यू गाइज कैन आंसर इट. टू क्वेश्चंस ओवर हियर आर होमवर्क क्वेश्चंस, दिस वन, एंड आई वांट यू गाइज टू मैसेज मी ऑन टेलीग्राम द आंसर्स टू दीज होमवर्क क्वेश्चंस. इफ आई डोंट गिव यू गाइज होमवर्क, यू विल नॉट गो एंड रिवाइज इट लेटर. द फर्स्ट टू क्वेश्चंस यू विल आंसर राइट नाउ. So what is the rate at which an ECG machine runs? So you have ECG paper running and the markings on the markings being carried out on the ECG. So what is the rate of that running of the paper? Anjana, we will come to deviation and everything, don't worry. Very good, Anjana. So the ECG machine paper runs at a standard rate of 25 millimeter per second. Okay, now we have all these large squares. Can you see? This is called as the large square. Or ek large square ke under we have under. Sorry, not under. Ek large square ke under we have 5 small squares. Aise. Okay. So now tell me, this one large square is how many millimeters and it signifies how many seconds? Very good, Anjana. So one large square will signify 5 mm. So if you see inside, I will just magnify and draw it for you over here. ऐसा 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 ऐसे 5 mm हो जाता है. ओके, एंड दिस वन लार्ज स्क्वायर इफ यू टेक दिस मच टाइमिंग इट सिग्निफाइज 0.2 seconds. ओके, सो वेन यू लुक एट वन लार्ज स्क्वायर इट इज 5 mm एंड इट इज 0.2 seconds. इफ यू लुक एट वन स्मॉल स्क्वायर, दिस इज योर लार्ज स्क्वायर. लार्ज स्क्वायर को यू आर डिवाइडिंग इन टू 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. इफ यू लुक एट दिस वन स्मॉल स्क्वायर, देन what does your one small square signify? Your one small square is equal to 1 mm. Obviously 5 divided by 5 will be 1 mm, and divided by 5, 0.2 divided by 5, it will be 0.04 seconds. ठीक है, तो ये थोड़ा बेसिक है ECG का that you should have, and two questions I am giving you as homework. If anyone can answer it now, right now also, very good. So if I have in 0.2 seconds, if I have one large square, okay, so in 60 seconds, that is 1 minute, how many large squares will I have? Can anyone answer this for me? So you can do a simple multiplication over here and come to the answer. 60 divided by 0.2, so that is equal to 300. Okay, so I have only answered your homework question, because I know you guys will not come back to me with the homework answer. So in the number of large squares per minute, that is in 60 seconds, is 300. Okay, and the number of small squares per minute will come up to 1500. 300 into 5, that will be 1500. Okay. Yes, absolutely correct. It will be 300. Isliye when we calculate the heart rate, you must have seen the formula for the heart rate. It is 300 divided by the interval between the number of large squares between two QRS complexes, or it is 1500 divided by the number of small squares between two QRS complexes. That is where the formula for heart rate has been derived from. Okay. फिर से बताती हूँ, आई नो इट इज़ अ लिटिल कन्फ्यूजिंग, सो आई विल बी हैप्पी टू एक्सप्लेन इट टू यू गाइज. सो वेन यू लुक एट वन लार्ज स्क्वायर, ठीक है, ये जो वन लार्ज स्क्वायर है, वेन यू लुक एट दिस वन लार्ज स्क्वायर, इट इज ऑफ 5 mm. ओके, साइज इज 5 mm एंड इट सिग्निफाइज 0.2 seconds. दिस विल सिग्निफाई 0.2 seconds. ओके, सो इन 1 मिनट हाउ मेनी लार्ज स्क्वायर्स विल आई गेट? So if in 0.2 seconds I am getting one large square, so in 60 seconds, that is 1 minute, how many large squares will I get? So if you calculate, you will get 300 large squares per 60 seconds, or 300 large squares per minute. And if you look at small squares, one large square has 5 small squares, so 300 into 5 will be 1500 small squares per minute. ओके, तो ये हमारा हो गया बेसिक्स ऑफ द ईसीजी पेपर. नाउ आई वांट यू गाइस टू कैलकुलेट द हार्ट रेट फॉर मी. आई गेव यू द फॉर्मूला, देर आर टू फॉर्मूलाज. ओके, वील कम टू दैट ओवर योर. सो वेन एवर यू हैव टू कैलकुलेट द हार्ट रेट, यू हैव टू नो वन वेरी सिंपल थिंग. द फर्स्ट थिंग यू हैव टू सी इज वेदर योर रिदम इज रेगुलर or whether it is irregular rhythm. Okay, so what do you mean by rhythm is regular or rhythm is irregular? So when you look at your distance between the RR waves, that is the QRS complexes, okay, so if you see the distance between the QRS complexes, if it remains constant, here you can see it is two large squares, if it's remaining constant, that means your rhythm is regular. Now have a look at the RR waves over here, or the QRS complexes over here. So if you see the distance between them, either it is 3 large squares, either it is 2 large squares, either it is 2 large squares, either again 3 large squares, either again 3 large squares, either 4 large squares. So this distance is changing continuously. So in this case, If the distance between my RR waves or QRS complexes is changing, then I say that my rhythm is irregular rhythm. Okay? Now, whenever you calculate the heart rate, the first thing you have to see is whether your rhythm is regular or irregular, because the formula for regular and irregular rhythm is different. So, let's have a look at this. Okay. Now, I'll give you an easy one first. So, can anyone calculate the heart rate for me in the first ECG? The first ECG, as we have seen, it has regular rhythm. You know the formula already for the heart rate, 300 divided by the number of big squares in between two R waves. Number of big squares in between two R waves. So, iska heart rate calculate karke bolo mujhe kitna hai? Very good. It is 300 divided by, there are two big squares in between two R waves. So, it is 150 beats per minute. Okay. Now, when you have an irregular rhythm, can anyone calculate the heart rate over here in the irregular rhythm and tell me how much it is? This is the formula you need to remember, and I want to see if anyone can calculate the heart rate and tell me over here. It's a little difficult because ECG is a little chotu dikh raha idhar, but it's still doable. Guys, if you're liking this session, please don't forget to leave a thumbs up. Huh? Okay, Devesh, very good. The answer is 80. Superb. Okay, so how to calculate the heart rate in an irregular rhythm? So, in an irregular rhythm, first you will mark 15 big squares in the ECG. ठीक है? पहले तुमने देख लिया, तुमको question में पूछ रहे हैं कि calculate the heart rate. यहाँ पे तुमने देख लिया कि RR interval irregular है, तो this is irregular rhythm. So, what do? You will mark 15 big squares. So, you mark 1, 2, 3, 4, ऐसे करके 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Okay? So, 15 big squares ends over here. ये तुमने mark कर लिया 15 big squares. उसके बाद, what you do is you count the number of R waves from number 1 to number 15. So, you have 1, 2, 3, 4. You have 4 R waves over here. So, you have to count the number of R waves in 15 big squares, that is 4, and multiply it by 20. So, your heart rate is 80 beats per minute. Okay? So, this is your heart rate, 80 beats per minute. Clear? Okay? So, this is the easiest way. There are other ways to calculate also. There is 6-second rule, as Dhrup is saying. There are other ways also to calculate an irregular heart rate, but this is the easiest way to calculate an irregular heart rate. So, mark 15 big squares and then calculate the number of R waves in that, 1, 2, 3, 4, and then there are 4 R waves, so just multiply it by 20. Okay, so your heart rate is 80 beats per minute. Clear? Okay. Now, we go on to your ECG. Okay, now we go on to axis deviation. So, we have learned how to see regular and irregular rhythm. We have learned how to calculate the heart rate in regular and irregular rhythm. Now, we will go to calculation of your axis. Okay, now axis, if you see, if you are doing MD medicine, then you have to do actually calculate the degree of axis deviation, whether it is normal axis, left axis deviation, right axis deviation, based on the degrees. Okay, but when you are doing for a basic exam like FMG, NEET, PG, next exam, you just need to know whether there is right axis deviation or left axis deviation. So, I will teach you a very simple way to identify that. Okay, so first of all, you need to identify what is axis deviation. तो अभी क्या है, this is your heart. Suppose your right ventricle starts hypertrophying because of any reason. Maybe there is pulmonary embolism or there is some valve stenosis. Okay, so in that case, pulmonary valve stenosis or anything like that, or back pressure coming from the lungs, If you have right ventricular hypertrophy, you will see that the right ventricle starts occupying most of the space and the left ventricle becomes chotu. Okay, so in that case your axis will start moving towards the right, your heart will tilt like that towards the right. So that will be your final axis, you will have a right axis deviation. On the other hand, if you have left ventricle hypertrophy because of any reason, your axis will start deviating towards the left. So you will have left axis deviation in that case. Clear? Okay. Now how do you identify right axis deviation and left axis deviation? Very easy to answer this. So look at lead 1 and look at lead AVF. Okay. Now in lead 1 and lead AVF, you have to look at the QRS complex. So here if you can see, the QRS complex over here in 1 is going down and in AVF is coming up. So main idhar isko draw kar deti hu, in 1 is going down and in AVF when I look at the QRS complex, it is going up. So what are they both doing? They both are reaching towards each other. They are reaching towards each other. Okay, the QRS complex in 1 and AVF. So when they are reaching, R for reaching towards each other, it is right axis deviation. Okay. Similarly, if you look at QRS complex in 1 and AVF, so you can see over here, it is going like this. This is called as a positive wave. If it's going in the opposite direction like this, it is called as a negative wave. Okay. So your 1 may QRS complex is going up, and when you look over here in AVF your QRS complex is going down. Okay. So abhi humne ye draw kar diya. So you can see 1 may it's going up, AVF may it's going down. So your QRS complexes are leaving from each other. They are going ulta. They are leaving each other. Okay. So L for leaving and L for left axis deviation. Clear? So if your QRS complex in 1 and AVF is reaching towards each other, it is right axis deviation. If it is leaving from each other, it is called as left axis deviation. Clear? So, khatam. Hamara ye kahani khatam of axis deviation. So, what have we done today? I mean, we are going to continue, don't worry. So, we have basically seen which wall is shown by the chest leads, which wall is shown by the limb leads. After that, we did how to see your regular and irregular heart rate, regular and irregular rhythm, then heart rate in regular and irregular rhythm, and then we did your how to identify left axis and right axis deviation. So these are the basic questions that will be asked in your exam. Don't go too much into detail also about ECG, because if you get confused in the exam, when they ask you a simple question, you'll be thinking something too complicated and you will end up making a mistake. Okay. Now we have to look at the normal intervals in our ECG. So what are the intervals telling you about? How much is the normal interval? Wo sab aana chahiye. Okay. So here we have your P wave, QRS wave, T wave, U wave, as I told you. Now your PR interval is from the start of your P wave to the end of your QRS wave. So what does it signify? Start of your P wave means this is the time when the SA node is giving out the impulse and the atria are contracting. So from the generation of the impulse from the SA node to the time that the, so I'll draw it over here and show you. ये तुम्हारा इम्पल्स जनरेट हो रहा है, इम्पल्स इज स्टार्टिंग ऑफ एन एसए नोड एंड द इम्पल्स इज स्प्रेडिंग 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 टू योर एवी नोड. सो दिस मच टाइम फॉर इम्पल्स टू स्प्रेड फ्रॉम एसए नोड टू एवी नोड, दिस इज गिवन बाय योर पीआर इंटरवल. ओके, सो हाउ मच टाइम डज दैट टेक दिस स्प्रेड फ्रॉम एसए नोड टू एवी नोड, दैट पीआर इंटरवल नॉर्मली टेक्स 0.12 टू 0.20 सेकेंड्स. Now you should also be knowing this in the number of small squares, because when you see the degree of heart blocks mein you should be able to count the number of small squares and see whether it is increased PR interval or decreased PR interval. So as I told you before, one small square is equal to 0.04 seconds. Okay? So into 3 agar tum karoge, so that will be 0.12. And into 5 agar karoge, so that will be 0.20. Okay? So basically your PR interval, normal PR interval is between 3 to 5 small squares. This is your normal PR interval. Okay? Next we have QRS duration. So this is your QRS duration. Okay? So this is very very important. Your QRS is supposed to be a narrow complex. Now why is it a narrow complex? Let me draw it over here and show you guys. Okay? So as I told you, your impulse spreads from SA node to AV node. AV node say to bundle of His, and then this bundle of His has this specialized conducting tissue called as the left bundle branch and the right bundle branch. Barabar? So now when the impulse spreads through the left and the right bundle branch, so those bundle branches will cover both the ventricles very quickly. They are specialized conducting tissue. So wo dono ventricle ko it will electrify quickly and both the ventricles will get depolarized and they will contract simultaneously. Okay? But if there is some problem with the bundle branch, okay, suppose there is some problem with the right sided bundle branch, so either say SA node to AV node to bundle of His, and bundle of His say to left bundle branch, to acche se ja raha impulse. But if you look on the right side, the right bundle branch is not working, so the impulse has to spread through this muscle, ventricular muscle. Now this ventricular muscle is not a specialized conducting tissue. Okay, it is very very slow. Your conducting tissue of the bundle branches is very fast, and your ventricular muscle conducts these impulses extremely slowly. So because of this you get a bundle branch block. So we will see this ahead, how do you see a bundle branch block on ECG. But generally what happens is your QRS complex, if you see, is just 2 to 3 small squares. Okay, fatafat se ho jata hai. Your QRS complex is telling you about your ventricles contracting, left and right ventricle contracting. So what will happen is generally when the impulse is spreading through the bundle branches, both of them contract very quickly, the QRS will be just 2 to 3 small squares. But if you have a bundle branch block, then in that case, from the, as I told you over here, yahan se it's going to the left bundle branch normally, so the left side will contract quickly. Okay, but the right side, that time the impulse is spreading through the ventricular muscle because the right bundle branch is not working, so the right ventricle contracts slowly. So this, see your QRS complex, this is your normal QRS complex. It's hardly so narrow, and when you have a bundle branch block, your QRS complex becomes so widened. Okay, this is because your QRS is taking more time. And why is your QRS taking more time? Because your ventricles are taking more time to contract. So this is your whole idea behind a bundle branch block. That is why in a bundle branch block you will always have a widened QRS complex. Samajh mein aaya? Have you all understood this concept, or do I need to tell you guys about it again? Those of you who have not understood this concept of bundle branch block, please tell me. I will be happy to repeat it for you. And those who have understood also can tell that they have understood, so that I know that what I am teaching is not going way above your heads. Okay? Itna agar tum ECG aise conceptually padhoge na, so you will always remember it for life. Okay? Clear na? Okay, so normally your QRS is very narrow because through the bundle branches both the ventricles get electrified quickly and they contract quickly. But if any one bundle branch is not working, then it will take time for the impulse to spread through the ventricular muscle, and as a result of this the ventricle will contract slowly. So if the ventricle is contracting slowly, you will have a wide QRS complex. Okay? Okay. Now we have seen the QRS duration, we have seen the PR interval. So PR interval, remember, it's important for our heart blocks. QRS duration is important for our bundle branch blocks. Now next we have our QT interval. So QT interval is from the beginning of your Q wave to the end of your T wave. So this is the main part of your contraction of the heart that is happening. Your ventricle is contracting, then your ventricle is repolarizing and it is relaxing. Okay, so this is your entire QT interval, it is giving you the most important part. Now, why is QT interval very important? Because your ventricle contraction and relaxation, this is the main thing that is required for pumping the blood from the heart to the, all the parts of the body, to the aorta, to the pulmonary artery, to systemic and pulmonary circulation. So your QT interval normally is 400 to 430 milliseconds. It's lesser in females, it's around 400 milliseconds in females, and it's about 440 milliseconds in males. So this is your normal QT interval. Now in your exam, they ask you questions like, which of these drugs cause prolonged QT interval? Prolonged QT interval means it's taking more time for contraction of the ventricle and more time for the relaxation of the ventricle. So you have all your anti-malarial drugs like quinine, all those drugs which cause prolonged QT interval. Okay, so you should know all those drugs. I have forgotten in pharmacology kya the wo, to aana chahiye wo. Okay, next we have the RR interval. So the distance between two QRS complexes. Now it's not very important to remember the RR interval, but you should just see if the RR interval remains constant, the distance between two R's remains constant, or it keeps on changing. That will tell you about your regular and irregular rhythm. Okay, so this is about our different intervals. Okay, now next, this is everything normal, and then we will start looking at little abnormal ECGs. So your normal heart rate is between 60 to 100 beats per minute. If your heart rate is less than 60, we call it as bradycardia. If your heart rate is more than 100, we will call it as tachycardia. अभी उसमें भी अलग-अलग चीज़ होती है, sinus bradycardia, heart blocks. In tachycardia, you will have sinus tachycardia, then you will have your supraventricular tachycardia, ventricular tachycardia, all those things we will see. Okay, then your normal PR interval, as we discussed, 0.12 to 0.2 seconds, that is 3 to 5 small squares. Your normal QRS interval, as we discussed before, less than 0.12, that is 2 to 3 small squares. Okay, your SA node discharge rate is 60 to 100 beats per minute, and your AV node discharge rate is 40 to 60 beats per minute, and your ventricular tissue discharge rate is 20 to 40. अभी ये सब लोग बोलेंगे, है ये क्या है मैम? ओके, अभी क्या होता है ना, why are you getting your normal heart rate? Over here we are saying our normal heart rate is 60 to 100 beats per minute. Why? Because normally the SA node is the pacemaker. So it will start giving out beats at the rate of 60 to 100 beats per minute. That's why we call it as normal heart rate. Okay, now for some reason, suppose something is wrong with the SA node, either some drug or some ischemia which is causing the SA node to malfunction. The SA node is not functioning properly. So if the SA node does not want to be the pacemaker, then next is the AV node. The AV node has to take up the responsibility. So when the AV node starts becoming the pacemaker, it can generate impulses at the rate of 40 to 60 beats per minute. ठीक है? So इससे क्या पता चलेगा? If you see your ECG and you see that your heart rate, you start calculating your heart rate and you see that your heart rate according to the RR interval is coming up to 45 beats per minute. So what can you think in that case? You can think, maybe my SA node is not the pacemaker, maybe my AV node is the pacemaker over here. So you can also call it as AV nodal rhythm. Okay, now in some cases the atria is not working at all. SA node bhi nahi chal raha, AV node bhi nahi chal raha, dono nahi chal raha. So in that case, what do you have? Your ventricle muscle ka ek part, any one part, starts becoming the pacemaker and starts giving out impulses. Okay, it will give out impulses and that will spread through the muscle to the ventricle. This is usually jab hi hum CPR de rahe hote hain, when we are giving cardiopulmonary resuscitation, when you give a lot of adrenaline to the patient, lot of chest compression to the patient, when the patient starts getting revived, at that time your ventricular tissue starts becoming the pacemaker. Before your SA node becomes pacemaker, you will see that your some point in the ventricular tissue starts becoming the pacemaker. So If your heart rate over here is between 20 to 40 beats per minute on the ECG, you can think that maybe the ventricle is the pacemaker. Okay? Alright. Now, looking at the normal sinus rhythm. Before we go to the abnormal rhythms, I want you guys to look at the normal sinus rhythm. Okay? Sinus rhythm means your SA node, your sinoatrial node is the pacemaker. Okay, that means your sinus rhythm. Okay, so in your normal sinus rhythm, what do you see over here? You see your heart rate. Your heart rate, if you calculate over here, can anyone calculate the heart rate for me in the CCG and tell me? I taught you guys how to calculate the heart rate. So now calculate the heart rate and tell me how much it is. Meanwhile, you can see, first thing to see is whether the rhythm is regular or irregular. So these are my two RR, you can see 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, almost 3 and a half squares, okay? 3 big squares if I take. So between RR, there are 3 big squares everywhere. It is constant, it is the same. So this is a regular rhythm, okay? Now tell me, what is the heart rate over here? Anyone? Devesh is saying 100, Dhrup is saying 60. What was the calculation of a regular heart rate? 300 divided by the number of big squares in between two R waves. So how many big squares are there? 3. So 300 divided by 3. So the heart rate over here is 100 beats per minute. Okay? It's actually a little lesser than 100 beats per minute because there are almost 3.5 big squares if you see, but just to make your calculation easier over here, I have considered that there are 3 big squares between 2 RR waves. Okay, so your heart rate over here is 100 beats per minute. 300 divided by the number of big squares, 1 big square, 2 big square, 3 big square in between 2 R waves. Okay, now the third criteria for a sinus rhythm is you should have a P wave. And every P wave should be followed by a QRS wave. So, uska ulta kya hai? If you are having a QRS wave, then her QRS wave ke pehle there should be a P wave. That means the impulse is coming from the SA node. So, then the atria are contracting. Then the impulse is spreading to the AV node. And then it is spreading to the bundle branches. So, you have your QRS complex in which your ventricles are contracting. Then you have your T wave in which your ventricles are relaxing. Then similarly, next beat. Okay, your PR interval should be 0.1 to 0.2 seconds. So if you see between your P wave and your R wave, you will see 3 to 5 small squares. So over here, I can see about 3 small squares in between P to R wave. So this is my normal PR interval. Okay, and my QRS wave, if you see, it is about 2 small squares in size. 2 small squares in size. So that is my QRS wave over here. If I calculate, is about 0.08 seconds. So normal QRS wave is 0.08 to 0.12 seconds. So everything over here is normal. So this is my normal sinus rhythm. Okay. Now you all must be bored. You all must be like, abhi se ma'am hi baat kar rahi hai. Humko kuch pooch nahi rahi hai ECG ke baare mein. To chalo, mujhe ye dekh ke abhi batao ki ye ECG kya hai. And what is the problem in this ECG? Kuch to I send one intern, I say ki wo casualty mein patient hai, uska ECG leke aajo. To wo jaake aisa ECG leke aajata hai. And then, mujhe aise baithna padta hai, ki ye kya ECG leke aaya hai, isko class mein padhana chahiye tha ki ECG kaise lena hai, kaise dikhta hai. Kuch to drawing khud hi karke aa gaya hai. But the intern is telling me, madam, maine to barabar se liya ECG. So what, I'm sending him back again to take the ECG again. So what change can he do in that case? I send him back. I say, nahi, khud ja, abhi fir se ja ke ECG leke aao. So what should he do next? Batao. No, no, no polymorphic VT. Can you see anything properly over here? You can't see P wave, you can't see QRS wave, you can't see T wave. Arre kuch bhi nahi samajh mein aa raha hai ye ECG mein to. ओके ऑल राइट, अभी ये ईसीजी में क्या हो रहा है, इट इज देयर इज पुअर कॉन्टैक्ट ऑफ द लीड्स विथ द पेशेंट्स चेस्ट. ओके, तो जो तुम्हारा ईसीजी लीड होता है, इफ यू गाइस हैव सीन इट, अगर कभी ईसीजी लिया होगा तो यू मस्ट हैव सीन दैट यू अप्लाई अ लॉट ऑफ जेली सो दैट द जेली इज अ गुड कंडक्टर ऑफ इलेक्ट्रिसिटी. ओके, सो इट मेंटेन्स अ गुड कॉन्टैक्ट बिटवीन द स्किन एंड द इलेक्ट्रोड. अभी वो कभी कभी क्या होता है, इफ़ यू यूज पुराने लीड्स या फिर यू पुट लेस अमाउंट ऑफ जेली, देन देर इज नो गुड कॉन्टैक्ट बिटवीन द स्किन एंड द इलेक्ट्रोड दैट यू आर पुटिंग ऑफ द ईसीजी. ओके, तो अगर दैट इंटर्न हैज डन एक नंबर की कंजूसी एंड ही हैज नॉट पुट जेली प्रॉपरली, दिस इज द काइंड ऑफ ईसीजी यू विल गेट. दिस इज बिकॉज ऑफ पुअर कॉन्टैक्ट. ओके, दिस इज बिकॉज ऑफ पुअर कॉन्टैक्ट. ओके, नाउ नेक्स्ट ईसीजी. नाउ आई सेंड अनदर इंटर्न फॉर अनदर पेशेंट. ही सेज मैडम पेशेंट का ईसीजी है. I look at the ECG and then I look at the patient's monitor. ठीक है, patient को pulse ox लगाया है और monitor लगाया है कुछ, तो pulse ox पे it is showing heart rate of 74. तो मैं I'll go and palpate the pulse. I count the pulse for 1 minute and I see that the pulse is 74. लेकिन ये ECG दिख रहा है. अभी मुझे ये बताओ कि ये ECG में heart rate कितना है and what is the problem? First of all, is this a regular or irregular heart rate? Is this a regular or irregular heart rate? If you look at this, then 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, again 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. Almost इधर इसका आधा calculate किया और इसका आधा calculate किया तो 6. Okay, so it is a regular heart rate. If you see over here, this is a regular heart rate. RR interval is coming constant. ठीक है, अभी इसमें heart rate calculate करो कितना है. 300 divided by the number of big squares. So the number of big squares that was there was 6. So 300 divided by 6, 50 beats per minute. ये कैसे हो सकते हैं, इधर 50 beats per minute in ECG and इधर 74 beats per minute on palpation of the pulse. अरे ये क्या problem हो रही है, गलत पेशेंट का ईसीजी लेके तो नहीं दिखा रहे मुझे किधर. सोचो सोचो क्या हो सकता है. एनीवन, ऐसे क्वेश्चन भी तुम्हारे क्लिनिकल के सिनेरियोज में आ सकता है. ओके, किसी को नहीं पता चल रहा, ह्यूमन एरर. नहीं नहीं, क्या एरर ह्यूमन का. ओके, तो रिमेंबर आई टोल्ड यू सम टाइम अगो कि ई सी जी का पेपर स्पीड कितना होना चाहिए, दैट ई सी जी पेपर विल मूव एट अ स्पीड ऑफ 25 mm/s. ओके, कभी कभी वॉट विल हैपन, सम टेक्नीशियंस विल चेंज द स्पीड ऑफ द ई सी जी पेपर. सो समटाइम्स दे मे चेंज द स्पीड टू 50 mm/s, समटाइम्स दे मे चेंज द स्पीड टू 12.5 mm/s. So if you are changing the speed of the ECG, you will see this difference between the heart rate calculated in the ECG and the heart rate that is actual there in the pulse of the patient. Okay, now how will you identify over here whether your heart rate is actually faster or slower as compared to the ECG? So now just think of this. Okay, just imagine yourself. Suppose maine tumko ek motorcycle di. You are riding the motorcycle and I give you 5 coconuts. In your bag, I give you 5 coconuts. Now, if you are riding your motorcycle very fast, will you be able, and I tell you that try to drop a coconut at every 100 meters ka distance. So, will you be able to drop a coconut at every 100 meters ka distance properly when you are driving very fast or when you are driving very slow? If you are going very slowly, can you drop every coconut at 100 meters? Or if you are driving very fast, you can drop every coconut at 100 meters. Soch ke mujhe batao. Thoda difficult concept hai to understand. That's why I'm trying to make it easy for you guys. You are on the bike. I give you two options. You have to drop every coconut at 100 meters. Will you drive slowly to drop the coconut or will you drive fast to drop the coconut? Barabar. So, if you are driving at a very slow pace, if your ECG paper is going at a very slow pace, like 12.5 millimeters per second, then the ECG paper can mark more QRS complexes. Okay, so if the paper is very slow, then it can mark more QRS complexes. So if I am marking more QRS complexes, then the distance between two QRS complexes will be less, so that will show a falsely high heart rate. Okay, on the other hand, if my ECG paper is moving too fast or if my motorcycle is moving too fast, I am hardly able to drop the coconuts, I am hardly able to mark, this is too fast, so I am hardly able to mark the complexes. So in this case, I am able to mark one QRS complex over here, bahut fast chal raha paper, another QRS complex over here, another QRS complex over here. So here the distance between my QRS is more. So it will show a falsely low heart rate. Okay? So when you are having your paper going at a very slow speed, you are marking more QRS. So you are showing a falsely high heart rate. And if your paper is going at a very high speed, it's going very fast, it can hardly mark any QRS complexes. So you're showing a falsely low heart rate. Okay? So whenever you get a difference between your palpated pulse and the ECG heart rate, that means your ECG paper is not running at the correct speed. Okay? All right. I know it is a little difficult concept to understand. What you can do is you can come back to this part later when you are re-watching this class. You can come back to this later and try to listen to what I have said and make sense out of it. And if you don't understand it, I will explain it again. Okay? Now, again, what has happened to this patient? Now, ECG is put together, but why is it like this in ECG? What is happening to the patient? Only another 10 minutes, huh, guys, then we'll stop the class, don't worry. Last 10 minutes of the class. Dhruv, since over here the heart rate is more and it is showing a falsely low heart rate, okay? That means my paper is moving at a higher speed. So my paper was moving at double the speed, 50 millimeters per second. Okay. Arrhythmia nahi hai, this patient is having shivering. Okay, so if your patient is having shivering all over the ECG, you will see SASS is a fibrillatory waves jaise aata hai. Okay, agar shiver kar raha hai to ekdam aise fibrillatory waves jaise aata hai. Okay, all right. Now let's move on to some of our abnormal rhythms. So what all did we see? We saw a normal sinus rhythm. Then we saw poor contact of ECG, we saw false movement of the paper speed is not correct, then shivering. Now we will move to sinus bradycardia. So first tell me, when do you call that the patient has bradycardia? What was the definition that I told you guys? What was the definition for bradycardia? Okay, so less than 60 beats per minute was the definition for bradycardia. When do I say it is sinus bradycardia? When my SA node, the pacemaker is producing impulses very slowly. So if the SA node is producing impulses very slowly at a rate of less than 60 beats per minute, so that is only called as sinus bradycardia. So how will you identify sinus bradycardia? You will see that there is a proper PE wave, there is a proper QRS complex, there is a proper T wave, sab kuch barabar hai, but the distance between two QRS complexes is high. Okay, so the distance over here, if you see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, almost 7 big squares in between two R waves. Okay, so this comes to 300 divided by 7. तो कितना हुआ ये?
70.
मैं तो मैथ्स भूल गई. सो हार्ट रेट विल बी समवेयर अराउंड 45. ओके, तो काफ़ी लो हार्ट रेट है, बट पी वेव इज देयर, क्यू आर एस वेव इज देयर, द पी आर इंटरवेल इज नॉर्मल, एवरीथिंग इज फाइन. सो दैट मीन्स माई पेस मेकर ऑफ द हार्ट, माई एस ए नोड इज ओनली प्रोड्यूसिंग एवरीथिंग एट अ स्लोअर रेट. ओके, सो दिस इज योर साइनस ब्रैडीकार्डिया. नाउ साइनस ब्रैडीकार्डिया के बाद यू हैव योर हार्ट ब्लॉक. ओके, सो इन हार्ट ब्लॉक देर विल बी वन कॉमन थिंग, योर पी आर इंटरवेल विल बी एबनॉर्मल. ओके, योर पी आर इंटरवेल विल बी एबनॉर्मल. नाउ इन योर हार्ट ब्लॉक्स वी हैव फर्स्ट डिग्री हार्ट ब्लॉक, सेकेंड डिग्री हार्ट ब्लॉक एंड थर्ड डिग्री हार्ट ब्लॉक. सो आई गिव यू अ वेरी नाइस स्टोरी टू रिमेंबर फर्स्ट, सेकेंड एंड थर्ड डिग्री हार्ट ब्लॉक. दिस इज माई पेटेंट स्टोरी. तो इसमें क्या होता है, फर्स्ट डिग्री हार्ट ब्लॉक. ओके, सो इफ यू सी ओवर हियर, दिस इज योर पी वेव, दिस इज योर क्यू आर एस कॉम्प्लेक्स, दिस इज योर पी वेव, दिस इज योर क्यू आर एस कॉम्प्लेक्स, दिस इज योर पी वेव, दिस इज योर क्यू आर एस कॉम्प्लेक्स. ओके, नाउ सी द डिस्टेंस बिटवीन पी एंड क्यू आर एस. हाउ मच डिड वी से वॉज आर नॉर्मल पी आर इंटरवल? 3 to 5 स्मॉल स्क्वेयर्स. इफ यू सी ओवर हियर, द नॉर्मल द पी आर इंटरवल ओवर हियर is about 6 small squares and it is fixed. It is 6 small squares over here, it is 6 small squares over here, 6 small squares. So this is not changing, it is fixed. After every P wave you are getting a QRS wave. It's not like the QRS wave is not happening. Okay, so what is the problem over here in first degree heart block? This is your SA node, this is your AV node, and the passage of your impulse from SA to AV is taking more time. That is why your PR interval is increased, but it is fixed. It is 6 small squares. Okay, so this is your first degree heart block. So this is similar to a long distance relationship. When it initially starts, the boyfriend and the girlfriend, both of them will meet at increased intervals. So they are in a long distance, Mumbai, Delhi. So they will meet at the end of every month. So the distance between them is increased, the duration after which they are meeting is increased, but it is fixed. So the boyfriend and the girlfriend initially say we'll meet at the end of every month. So it is prolonged PR interval, or the meeting interval is prolonged and fixed. Okay, now after that we have second degree heart block. In second degree heart block we have Mobitz type 1, also called as Venki back, and we have Mobitz type 2. Okay, these are both second degree heart block. तो अभी क्या होता है लॉन्ग डिस्टेंस रिलेशनशिप में, फर्स्ट दे वर मीटिंग एट द एंड ऑफ एवरी मंथ. नाउ देर आर टू टाइप्स ऑफ बॉयफ्रेंड्स. इनिशियली तो सब कर लिया, हर मंथ के एंड में मीट मिल गए. बाद में क्या बोलते हैं, देर आर टू टाइप्स ऑफ बॉयफ्रेंड्स. अगर ये बैड बॉयफ्रेंड है, अगर ये वेंकी बैड है, आई रिमेंबर इट एज वेंकी बैड, तो वॉट ही विल से, पहले ही सेज कि I will come at the end of 1 month. Then he says I will come at the end of 1 month 15 days. Then he says I will come at the end of 1 month, 1.5 month के end में आता हूँ. And then उसके बाद आता ही नहीं है एक महीना. ठीक है, सीधा miss कर देता है वो. Again you will see over here, he comes at the end of 1 month, then he comes at the end of 1.15 month, then at the end of 1.5 month. तो द डिस्टेंस और द पी आर इंटरवल इज प्रोलोंगिंग एंड यू हैव अ ड्रॉप्ड क्यू आर एस. यू ऑल्सो हैव अ ड्रॉप क्यू आर एस. सो द मीटिंग टाइम विल इंक्रीज, प्लस देर विल बी वन टाइम वेर ही विल नॉट एंड अप मीटिंग हिज गर्लफ्रेंड ओनली. ओके, सो दैट इज योर सेकेंड डिग्री हार्ट ब्लॉक और वेंकी बैक फिनोमिनन. द पी आर इंटरवल गोज ऑन प्रोलोंगिंग एंड देर इज ऑल्सो अ ड्रॉप क्यू आर एस. Then your second degree heart block or Mobitz type 2 mein, your PR interval is normal. If you see your PR interval is normal, it is about 3 small squares, but there is a dropped QRS at every regular interval. So here you have a ratio blocked. Okay, you have a dropped QRS at regular interval. So after every 3 normal beats, you are having a dropped QRS. Again you will have over here 3 normal beats and drop QRS. So what is the ratio block over here? It is 3:1 block. That is your Mobitz type 2. Okay, and then finally you have third degree heart block. Third degree heart block mein full breakup ho gaya hai. So the QRS waves, as you can see over here, they are moving on their own. The distance between them is regular. The P waves, if you see, they are moving on their own. Okay, they are related to their own, and there is actually no relation between P and QRS. Your P is there, but there is no QRS. Your P is here, but the QRS is here. Okay, so there is no relation between P and QRS. So this is your complete atrioventricular dissociation, or this is also commonly called as third degree heart block. Okay, so we'll stop at this for today. I'll revise this for you. Sinus bradycardia mein heart rate is less than 60 beats per minute, and every P is followed by a QRS. PR interval is normal. When we go to your heart blocks, your PR interval in first degree heart block is prolonged and fixed. Your PR interval in second degree heart block, Mobitz type 1 or Wenckebach phenomenon, goes on increasing. PR interval goes on increasing, and you have a drop QRS. In second degree heart block, Mobitz type 2, you have a drop QRS, but PR interval remains constant and normal. Okay, so you have ratio blocks over here, 3:1, 4:1, 2:1, like that. And finally, third degree heart block mein, you have a complete atrioventricular dissociation. There's no relation between P and QRS, and you will have P moving on their own, QRS moving on their own, and no association between them. So that is your third degree heart block. So that's it for today's class. I hope you guys found this class useful. Of course, we have a lot more ECG to be done, and we will do it in the second part of this class. I will be taking that soon. And we'll finish all our tachycardias, all our different types of cardiac arrest rhythms, all of that in that. Okay, SVT, ventricular tachycardia, fibrillation, all of that. If you like this class, don't forget to hit the like button. Don't forget to hit the subscribe button. And I shall see you next time. From tomorrow, I'm starting a plus course on the Anacademy app for FMG students, in which I'm going to be completing the whole of anesthesia in 5 days. So you guys can join that if you want, and you can use my code Dr. Janvi Live for getting a 10% extra off on your plus subscription. So till then, take care, keep studying, and I will see you next time. Bye bye.